will be dry. Sunday, England and Wales, best favourite for the driest, especially further south in Easter Island, but windier and wetter again for Scotland and Northern Ireland. Naga, Charlie, back to you both.
Thanks, Matt.
Let's see, 7:47 is the time now. We're talking about pop partnerships now. Pop partnerships, Paul Heaton, pop partnerships, Paul.
Who's he?
Paul Heaton and Jackie Abbott. Perfect 10, you know the song.
What are they?
They're a pop partnership.
They've been knocking out bittersweet songs. They've been knocking out bittersweet songs for more than 30 years, and their new album is out today. Take a look at them in action. We've been reminiscing this morning about Saturday morning TV in the 90s. Watch out for another perfect partnership in one of those videos.
But suddenly he was leaving because I lost him to a DIY.
Good morning, Paul and Jackie. Good lovely morning. To see you. Your video is always a lot of fun. But, Paul, can I just say, I heard you mutter under your breath, got the same jacket on.
I wasn't sure. Yeah, I was looking at one of those old videos. Yeah,
I think it was the same jacket. The one you're sitting on the sofa and I think it was the same jacket.
You do my jackets a disservice. I think I've got several that are very similar.
They just look similar.
Yeah, they look similar.
That'll
yeah.
be what it is.
Yeah.
That'll
if
be
it
what
works,
it is.
If it ain't broke,
exactly.
Don't,
yeah,
why not?
Exactly.
Why not?
Do you ever give Paul fashion advice?
No. No. Because I seen something this morning, which very often he said, well, on stage, why didn't he take his jacket off?
Yeah.
The one time he took it off in Bridlington, people went berserk.
Yeah, they did.
In what way?
He was just so happy that he finally took his coat off on stage, you know.
But is it like some kind of comfort blanket? Do you feel...
A bit, yeah.
Like a and uniform, also, like, on stage, jacket on, I'm ready to go.
Yeah, it's a bit of protection and is stuff it? Like that, yeah, I think. So we're all quite shy, really, when we get up there, you know, it's, yeah.
Do you remember when that started? Do you remember when the...
Yeah, it would have been Beautiful South, definitely, when I probably started putting a bit of weight on, because I was quite skinny in the House Martin, so I was showing off in T-shirts. But, yeah, you just... And also, I think when we started playing arenas with the Beautiful South, I became more shy and became more introverted on stage. I'm a bit more, well, quite a lot more relaxed now, but, yeah, initially you sort of try and cover yourself up and... sunglasses or a hat or something like that.
It's, you know, it's something, isn't it? We people are so caught up with the imagery of musicians. Mm. I mean, it is a real pressure. I think in a way you kind of forget about it, and then you are always so relaxed, the way you sing, the way you present, your videos are such fun. But there is a massive pressure, isn't there? You must feel it as well.
Yeah, I can see with, you know, for any artist or whatever, if going somewhere or they're going to go to an awards thing or whatever, we've done many of them things like that, red carpet things like that, but you instantly feel anxiety around what instantly. So if you did that a lot, if you wanted to be in the limelight a lot like that, I can't imagine, it must be horrible.
You've always struck me as someone who doesn't particularly take that on board. I mean, just
no
but yeah, that'd be fair.
Definitely not. No, it's not one of them. When we first started years ago with the Beautiful South, it was one of them where we never... I knew I wasn't going into a band that didn't go down the route of everything. We have to be dressed pristine.
Have you ever been pushed that way? Of like, you know, your management or anything like that?
No, we were criticised in the press at the time, particularly with the Beautiful South, that we just looked like people stood at a bus stop. you know, which we sort of did, you know, to be fair, they had a point. Minus the shopping bags, you could have seen it as a...
This is cool though, Jackie, you don't look like...
There's been some that have been lovely, but you do class that as being dressed up into a character rather than dressed up for the sake of looking what you would deem a particular way, you know, whether it was sensational or...
Doesn't it make you just feel, if when someone says, oh, they just look like they're standing, I don't know, waiting for the bus, just fine. I'm going to stick to it.
There was a thing the other day, I was on about this to me oldest son, and I was telling him a story from years, don't know if you remember this, years ago, but I was doing two radio interviews in London, but one was a phone-in from another radio station, and the gentleman on the phone who spoke to us kind of threw in a comment of, you are a band for radio, really, aren't you? And I went, said the radio presenter. And I just sort of thought, and it was a really rude thing to say back, but I thought, actually, no, he just told us that we're pretty horrible to look at. So, and I was like, said the radio guy. And he was like, oh, good comeback. And I was like, well, yeah.
Face for radio.
Do you know what, though? I see it as quite the opposite way around. Because I did spend a bit of time last night watching some of the old videos and just going through this stuff. And I see it's precisely the opposite. It was absolutely part of the charm. I know it's completely genuine. It wasn't something you were putting on, but it was kind of the charm of the thing. Was you felt like you were accessible. You were going into pubs. There was a lot of joy around that. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't faked. It was very
real. No, I think there's a connection with our audience through the way we dress, unusually. And, you know, some other artists who've perhaps been wearing their expensive suits and... You know, Freddie Mercury, you know, Elton John, etc. That's a great, great show, but you can't imagine many people going out dressed like that.
I'd love to see it. Can I just say, on the record, I'd love to see it all. If you want to go for it sometime, feel free.
As soon as you wear your onesie that Nadia correctly encouraged you, I'll take you up
on it. It's on the Christmas list already.
Exactly.
It's on the Christmas... I tell you what, talking about connecting with your fans, now, more than ever, people need joy. Right, they do want to escape. Hence the Elton Johns and the, you know, Freddie Mercury's seeing that. But actually, when you're touring, you've put a cap on your price tickets, ticket prices, haven't you?
Yes, we have.
And I know you're really quite conscious about that because I'll talk about your birthday in a minute. But how's that gone down with your fans?
It's gone down really well, and with other fans, people have noticed it. You know, perhaps there was a discussion on social media the other night between Depeche Mode fans, and somebody pointed them out. So yes, it can be kept cheap by our tickets. It's really important, you know, through the coming months and possibly years, that we tell the fans that, you know, we're getting paid enough and we want to keep it low for you. And I think people are delighted that, because I'm very much against greed, you know, within the industry, because I feel as though there is quite a lot. And so we're trying to just battle and just say, look, we'll do it for as low as we can. And set a bit of an example. And I know Tom Grennan, who's obviously a younger artist, has also, you know, said he's going to try and keep his tickets low as well. So hopefully there'll be, hopefully it's a way forward that people will look and say, we don't want to charge £80, £90.
And I'll mention it because I want to talk about the music as well, that you gave £1,000 to various pubs near you for your 60th birthday to celebrate 60 pubs, wasn't it?
Yes, that's right.
So to give something back, and it was nice when they all said cheers to you. One of the songs, Still, very, very personal and delicate subject. It's about loss, bereavement of babies, miscarriage.
Yeah.
Where did you think the appetite was for that song?
I can't remember I've not got a very good memory these days, but I just wanted to write a song about loss. I didn't want to specify whether it be before, you know, whether it be miscarriage or later, so the song is deliberately played out over a few scenarios. And it was only when we'd written it and we started playing it back to the other band members that we realised how upsetting it was and how detailed it was. When I'm writing lyrics, I'm away in a different world. It could be anything I'm writing about, I'm just trying to finish the song. And so it sort of surprised myself that I'd written it in a way.
Should we just we listen in for just a moment?
We will love you still, Grandma and Grandpa are covered in shame.
and I feel it's a bit hard to kind of recover from a song like that, because straight away it takes us to a very different place. But you have always, your music has always managed to have a foot in both camps, you know. I think we use the phrase bittersweet, you know.
Yeah.
It has a lot of joy in it, but often it touches on difficult themes.
Yeah, right back from the first hit I had, Happy Hour, it was seen as, oh, it's a really a joyful pop song, but all the way through to things like Perfect 10, which dealt with weight issues, that we thought, well, let's get a good tune out there and say something serious behind it. So it's not been as intentional as it sounds, because I genuinely listen to a tune first when I listen to songs. And so the lyrics are quite heavy, the songs are light, and that's how it's just come out.
You turned 60.
I know, yeah.
How's that?
It's all right, actually. I describe it like getting relegated. You know, when you're going down to the fourth division, you think, oh, no, I'm going down to the fourth. And when you get there, it's Colchester away or Port Vale away. Do you know what I mean? And there's all these other attractions that come with being 60.
I'm going to follow the analogy.
But it's something you fear, but once you're there, you think, oh, actually, I can go to...
Do you follow this analogy? Do you just kind of like... Because what I have
noticed... There's been many, many analogies for this.
Paul does talk. You do talk.
I do,
and
yes,
you do.
I do
and you
talk,
sit sorry. There and you're just kind of like, just wait, biding your time and just kind
of letting
him crack on.
Me.
Letting him crack on. I just kind of wonder, like, is this the natural role?
No, he's got a lot of it. Well, it tends to have good descriptive things about, where, especially something like eyes, both the approaching and he's a storyteller, isn't he? So it's going to...
He's not going to shut up.
No, it's I know there was a big deal, like, you know, especially for something, because I'm 50, not this time, next year. So that'll be, I'll not shut up then. If you have me back, I'll not shut up then. I'll talk about it as well.
We'll always have you back. Beautiful voice.
And Paul will come up with some nonsense to make you feel okay about it.
Yes. Yeah. You're going down to the third division.
There you go, it's something like that.
There's lots of good new fixtures.
Exactly that.
I love how bemused you look. Just with it. Just like, here he goes again, but it's brilliant. The partnership works, obviously.
Lovely to see you both this morning. Thanks
for having us on.
Thank you.
Paul and Jackie's new album, MK Pop, is out now.
Stay with us, headlines in just a moment.
We need a holiday. Oh,